In today's video, we're going to be having a look at 5 new features in the recent 2021.11 update. Check it out. What's going on, guys? I hope you're all doing well. Now, it's not quite the first Wednesday of the month, and in fact, it's not even a Wednesday, but update 2021.11 did release a couple of weeks ago, and it was jam-packed full of features. Originally, I did plan on covering it, but I've been off for a couple of weeks due to being ill. But I'm back now, and I'm feeling good, and just in case you've been living under a rock and you're not sure what was included in that update, here's 5 new features that I really like. Up first, we've got entity categories. You'll know that when you add a new device to Home Assistant, you're going to gain a whole bunch of different entities. Now, some of these entities are going to be useful to you and you'll make use of them in your scenes and scripts, and some of them are just going to sit there cluttering up your Home Assistant. And that's pretty much where this entity categorization comes into play. So you're going to easily be able to view a device and you're going to be able to see what the device can do, what options you can change for it, and what information you're getting back from that device. And by default, lots of things that you're not going to make use of will be disabled. With entities, we've got 2 different categories. We've got configuration and we've got diagnostic. If an entity isn't categorized, it acts as a primary entity. A primary entity for a device would be a device's main control. So for example, if that device happened to be a smart bulb, then its main control would be turning on or off that bulb. And we can see that nicely categorized under controls just there. And back to those categories, as I mentioned, there's 2 different ones. We've got configuration and we've got diagnostic. The configuration entity acts as an entity that's got some kind of option or setting that can be adjusted and tweaked in order to affect the device. And then the diagnostic entities are entities that are going to give you information about the device. So that could be some kind of information that's reported, whether it be a sensor or something else. There's also changes with the ways that entities are represented within Home Assistant. And this is to do with that whole entity categorization changes. So with entities that are now non-primary entities, non-primary entities are now going to be hidden from your generated Lovelace dashboards. This is just one of those things that's going to help reduce clutter. In addition to this, your non-primary entities are now no longer going to be exposed to your Amazon Echoes or your Google Assistants. So now when you add a new device, you're not going to be spammed with the different Amazon Echo or Google notifications saying that all these new different entities have been found. And if you did want to expose some of these entities to your voice assistants, then you can. You're just going to need to go in and manually do that as it's no longer a default action. Non-primary entities are also not called by service calls that target the device or area that the device is in. And as these are all changes to the way that entities act and work, they are classed as breaking changes. So after you've done the update, if you're having issues with some of your scripts and automations, then this is more than likely the reason. One of the common issues that I've seen is that an entity's been disabled, so an automation and scene or script are now no longer seeing that actual entity. Up next, we've got configuration URLs and device links. So I think this feature and the one that we're going to have a look at just after this one are probably my 2 favorite features in the entire update, and it's just going to make your whole Home Assistant organization and management so much simpler and easier. So integrations can now provide URLs to where devices or services can be managed. And what this means is you'll be able to select your integration, and if it supports this feature, you'll see this visit device link here. And what that link's going to do is take you to either the configuration page or the service page for that particular device. So for example, I'm inside of the Tractive integration just here, and I can see that this particular integration supports this new feature as it's got that visit device link just there. And if you're not sure what Tractive is it's a subscription-based GPS service for tracking your pets. And if you're interested in finding out how that all works within Home Assistant, I've actually done a full video on that and you can find that linked above. But back to this example, so if I was to click this visit device link here, it would actually just jump me straight over to my configuration page for the Tractive service. So if I click that, it would take me to the Tractive website. And from here, I could just log in then and just edit all my different settings for my actual tracker. So integrations can link to external services, just like I showed you with Tractive, but it doesn't have to be an external service. It could just be a configuration for a device. So let's take a Tasmota device, for example. So within Tasmota, rather than having to remember the IP address for our device, we could just come into our device and we could just click visit device. And that'll jump us straight over to the Tasmota page for that particular device. So this is going to save us having to remember all those various different IP addresses or different web pages, and it's just going to make life super simple. Moving on to our 3rd feature, we've got the icon picker. If you watched the Home Assistant release parties, then you may have seen me shouting out for this feature, as I've been doing it for the last few months.
Material design icon picker support. I actually started on it. It's on a branch somewhere, like many other things.
So finally, an icon picker has been added into Home Assistant. So now when you set in an icon for a particular device or entity, you're actually going to get a drop-down list that's going to allow you to select a particular device from the material design icon pack. And a massive thank you to Paul Bertain for the awesome work that led to this being added in. And I'm sorry if I butchered your name, Paul. The implementation for the icon picker is super sleek and it's super quick. To set an icon, you're just going to simply need to find a device or entity that you want to change an icon for. When you select it, you'll notice that icon's now got a little drop-down next to it. And if you select that drop-down, it's going to show you a populated list of all the different material design icons that you can choose from. And you can just simply scroll through this list until you find an icon that you want, or you can do a search for a particular icon. So with this example, I've got the bedroom light. So if I start typing light, it's going to show me a list of all the different icons that are related to lights. And this is going to search for actual icons that have got the word light in, but it's also going to search the metadata, so anything that is to do with lights itself. Third-party icon packs can also utilize the icon picker. So if the author of these third-party packs adds compatibility, you'll be able to just search for an item that's in one of those packs and you'll just view it in your list of icons. Feature number 4 is a big update to the Tuya integration, which was added in 2021.10. In update 2021.10, the new Tuya integration was added into Home Assistant. This new integration replaced the original one, but it was missing a lot of features, which made a lot of users unhappy. Because so many users were unhappy with the integration and the overall experience, Frank went out and absolutely blitzed it. He added a ton of new features, rewrote multiple parts of the integration, and added more product support for a wide range of products. This gives the new Tuya integration some solid foundations ready to be worked on with future updates. The fifth and final feature of this update that I really love is an update to the VLC Media Player integration and add-on. I really like this feature, but I think it's one that might get overlooked a little bit, and I do have a full dedicated video for this particular feature coming out. But essentially what this feature allows you to do is to make use of the built-in Home Assistant text-to-speech and have it play through a connected speaker, and all you need to do is just connect that speaker to your Home Assistant Blue, your Odroid, or your Raspberry Pi. And there we go, that's been a quick look at 5 new features that I really like in 2021.11. There were plenty of other new features, integrations, and more all crammed into this update, but this happened to be 5 that I personally really liked. At the time of recording this video, the latest version of Home Assistant is currently 2021.11.5, so make sure you're running the latest version if you want to have all the latest bug fixes and features. One last thing if you didn't already see, on December 11th, Nabucasa, Home Assistant, and ESP Home are hosting an event for the State of Open Home. This is going to be a special event streamed live on YouTube, and it's going to cover Home Assistant's progress with creating an open home over the last 8 years. It's also going to feature guest appearances from the guys over at ZWave.js and the guys at WLED. If you're interested in that, you'll find a link to it in the description below. But we're going to wrap this one up here. This has been a nice one to get back into the whole YouTube swing after being away for a few weeks. Let me know in the comments below what your favourite feature was in this update. If you have enjoyed this video or found it useful, then don't forget to drop me a like. And if you're not already, hit that subscribe button. And if you ding dong the notification bell, you'll be alerted to any future video that I do. As always, a massive thank you to these awesome dudes. These awesome dudes are my Patreons. If you're interested in helping support my channel and becoming one of these awesome dudes, then you'll find a link to my Patreon in the description below. But thank you for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one. Cheers.